I appreciate having this opportunity to meet with all of you. I believe it's important that the federal government and the state attorney general have a strong and constructive working relationship. This administration and the Department of Justice under Attorney General Bill Smith have made that relationship a priority. And I noticed some familiar faces from last year's meeting. I also noticed a number of new faces, including Attorney General Brian McKay from Nevada and Attorney General John Bandicam from my home state of California. It's also true I've got a couple of other home states, Iowa and Illinois. But the large attendance that your conference has attracted is a comment on the need to confront the many law enforcement issues that face our society. Tomorrow I'll announce my intention to send to Congress a package of legislation in the criminal justice area. While there may be some difference over details, I believe there will be broad bipartisan support for these measures. I think many of you will be supportive of our ideas in the area of bail reform, exclusionary rule, habeas corpus, and sentencing. And I understand that you'll have the opportunity to discuss this package briefly after I leave this meeting. And incidentally, something has just developed is on the South Florida Task Force with regard to the concept with regard to drugs is being extended nationwide under the direction of the Vice President, as the South Florida Task Force is under his direction also. Ed Meese will fill you in on the details after I leave, which I understand I have to get out of here when we're still in session. But I just want to say again, the support from your organization, from you as individuals, will be extremely important. I look forward to your comments, not only on the crime package, but also on the issues that you will raise today. So I will now turn to your chairman, Attorney General William Vesti.
Mr. President, all of us are indeed honored. The chief legal officer of our state and all, and some are the chief law enforcement officers, and all have something to do with law enforcement. As you know, we span the broad spectrum of Republicans and Democrats and liberals and conservatives, but nevertheless, we've been able in this association to find common ground on the single issue that we all are opposed and want to do all we can to fight crime and to do the best we can to represent our states and the fiscal interests of our states. And that's where we stand one. On most issues, we're unanimous. On many, we're almost unanimous. So we're very happy that you've done this. This is the third time, by the way, that you very readily schedule this meeting. 3 years ago, you had scheduled it, and you were unavoidably delayed by an incident that took place that year.
Having to do with crime.
Very much so. So at this point, we want to make just a few points, and we understand that your agenda is crowded. We'd like John Ashcroft to say a word at this point.
Mr. President, we again want to express
our gratitude.
Good. I'm going to try to go around. I know everybody's pressed for time. Well, I appreciate all of you coming down here to review the nuclear arms resolutions before the Congress. I think we all share the concerns that motivated the Sablocki resolution, HJ Resolution 13, that passed in committee last week, However, a freeze at current levels would not promote progress in arms control. The contrary, it would make further progress in arms control difficult, if not impossible. And I know that our negotiators and opponents has so written and communicated to that effect. But it also hinder our long overdue modernization program and leave our aging forces increasingly vulnerable. I think we'll be putting out of the book this time, maybe there's a little more information for people on where we are and that we're not the great nuclear monster that can dominate the world as we were. We're quite behind the times. But let me review with you why we oppose this freeze first resolution. In Geneva, my administration has proposed 50% cuts in strategic ballistic missiles and the elimination of an entire class of intermediate range nuclear missiles. Now, a freeze would remove Soviet incentives to agree to reductions and be virtually impossible to verify. An example of that is to be found right now in the missile that they've recently tested and the charge that it violates our kind of gentleman's agreement that we've observed the terms of the SALT II treaty. We find that we really believe it does. We find that it is impossible for us to prove that it does. We can do better than a freeze at current levels. In the negotiations already underway, the Soviet Union has publicly recognized the need for reductions. Although Soviet proposals are vague, the Soviets have already gone further than they were willing to go in prior arms control negotiations. I've looked back over the history of them, and all the way back to World War II, our government has tried and tried, made proposals, and always has been reluctant at the other end. Understandably, therefore, we support the Broomfield-Kearney-Stratton-Price resolution, which expresses support for the ongoing nuclear arms reduction negotiations in Geneva, followed by a freeze at equal and substantially reduced levels. And we hope this resolution will find wide bipartisan support. We need to stick together, Republicans and Democrats, to set the right course toward meaningful arms control. If the Broomfield-Stratton version is not successful, you may wish to consider perfecting amendments to the Zablocki resolution. I recognize that the outlook for tomorrow's vote may not be promising, but I intend to continue to carry the truth to the American people. And we should convey to your colleagues my determination and personal commitment towards substantial, verifiable, equitable, and militarily significant reductions. And we are going to keep trying, and it's my belief that particularly in the INF talks, which started first, it's my belief that the Russians wouldn't even be at the table if it were not for our proposal to put missiles in as a deterrent on the NATO line and in the NATO, our NATO allies. As it stands today, they have, many people don't understand that they've continued building those SS-20 missiles all during these negotiations. They now have well over 1,000 warheads on those more than 300 missiles, and no deterrent of any kind in Western Europe. How do you have a freeze that leaves you more than 1,000-0 behind? And what deterrent is there then for anything? Well, that's my song. I'm sorry I kept you waiting. I tell you, it's kept the record straight. I have said, anytime I have to meet with congressmen, my schedule is off from then on. I just come from a meeting, a bipartisan meeting. Please sit down.
We absolutely had no problem. I'm a globe-trotted basketball game at the college when I get home. And they are, if I'm there at halftime, there's no problem. And the kids are going, our school's at spring break right now, and the basketball team is in the NAIA tournament. We won our first round, so we're down to the top 16. And we beat Charminat. We beat the University. Remember, the University of Virginia was beaten by a little school in Milwaukee called Charminat. So we got to have our hands full.
You know, well, first of all, before I say this, it's on basketball also, but let me thank you, first of all, for that ad. But more than that, I know what you've been doing yourself and on the radio and everything else in support of us. And I really want to tell you all grateful I am.
Well, I debated last
night. Nice to see you. President and the message, and the written message and the verbal.
Well,
and be honored to talk about it.
Well, I appreciate that very much.
Before the reception,
return to the warm greetings to you.
Thank you very much.
And the Prime Minister, Elisa.
For you?
Nice to see you. Again for you. Please tell President Jamayo that we believe we've made some progress in our talks with the Israeli Prime Minister, with Shamir, who has been here, is now going back. I'm sure we all understand they are concerned about security on the northern border. So are we, but we don't believe that they can obtain that security at the expense of Lebanese sovereignty. And I think that it's essential that we continue the dialogue, or that you perhaps continue the dialogue with Syria and PLO, because that's one of their concerns. They have a suspicion that Syrians and the PLO will drag their feet and try not to to leave.
Well, as we settled with them, the crime package at 1:30.
Oh, great.
And I guess there'll be a little discussion on that. But we're delighted to be doing it finally and giving a little attention. You know, this is an issue that...
The interesting thing is what the bleeding hearts on the Democratic side do about that now.
Well, I know. I've just spent 5.5 hours up there testifying before congressional committees. Yeah. And I'll have to say that is hard work.
I know.
These